My specialty is to date rocks, especially different successions like magmatic, metamorphic, but also sedimentary rocks. And for that, today, what I would like to discuss is about Precambrian geochronology and how to date different successions. What is the geochronology? What is the goal of geochronology? And when can you use it? So first of all, geochronology is the science of determining the age of rocks and or sometimes fossils using signatures inherent in rocks. So in geochronology, we use different tools. First of all, relative geochronology, which provided by tools such as paleomagnetisms or biostratigraphy. But we have also absolute geochronology, can be accomplished through radioactive isotopes. And by combining these different methods, we have a precision of the age for the rocks. So first of all, relative method. So this method make it possible to establish the age of the layer or geological bodies in relation to each other. And we have physical methods, but also paleontological methods. So in physical method, we have different well-known concepts used in different types of rocks, but essentially in sedimentary rocks. And the first concept was established by Nicolas Steno. And the first principle is the principle of the horizontality. So in the same layer, like here in a sedimentary succession, in the same layer, when we have two different samples, the two samples present the same age. So it's a really simple principle. The second one is the law of superposition. So when we have different layers, as in this example, the layer below, like here, the layer one, is older than the layer two, and the layer three, and the layer four. Here are two examples. First of all, in sedimentary rocks, it's in the Paris Basin in Normandy. So it's Cretaceous sedimentary succession. So we have older layer here and younger here. But it can be also applied in magmatic succession. Here is an example of different layers of lava in Iceland. But these principles are not always simple, like here in a big fold. We have also principle of cross-cutting, defined by Charles Lyell. So when a rock or a body, like a seal, a dike, or a fault, cut across another formation, often a sedimentary succession, it can be determined that the intrusion is younger than the formation. So here, the intrusion 4, 5, and 6 is younger than the sedimentary layer 1, 2, and 3. One example here is in the Barberton Greenstone Belt. We have different granitic seals here, cut across greenstone rocks here. We have also unconformity. So unconformity corresponds to a geological time where there is no deposit and or erosion, like in this example. And here we are in the Grand Canyon in United States. So where is the unconformity here? It's here, okay? Then we have also paleontological methods, which use biostratigraphy. So this method is widely used since the 18th century, and especially after Charles Darwin and the theory of evolution of the species. So this method uses fossiliferous assemblages, and these fossiliferous assemblages have changed over time. So each geological time is characterized by a particular assemblages, and the layer which contain these characteristic assemblages date this time. So what is a fossil? So fossils is the remains of organisms, for example, plants, animals, protists, or bacteria, found in sediment or in sedimentary rocks. And the most useful fossil for dating with this paleontological method are those that have a large horizontal extension, which means a large geographical distribution, and also a small vertical extension, which means a rapid evolution during time. So here are some examples. Here is graptolites. So it's a colonial animals known between the early Cambrian until the late Carboniferous. We have also the well-known trilobites, form one of the earliest known groups of arthropods. So the first appearance of these fossils is in the early Cambrian, and they disappeared in the mass extinction at the end of Permian. We have also very useful fossils, the microfossils. Here are some examples. So here it's organic rich microfossils like dinoflagellates, acritarchs, but also chitinozoans. And here some examples of carbonate rich microfossils like ostracods. So here are the stratigraphic distribution of microfossils during time. So we have here in blue the organic rich microfossils, in yellow the carbonate rich, in red the phosphate rich, and in green the silica rich. So as we can see, some exist since the Precambrian, like the acritarchs. Some are more recent, like here and here, and some are totally extinct. So we use also three methods to date layer with fossils. So briefly, it's the taxon range method, the fossiliferous assemblage, and the lineage one. So we use short-lived fossils that indicate specific age. So for the taxon range method. So this guide defines either by their appearance or by their disappearance bio event. And the layer containing one of these fossils can thus be dated with sufficient precision. But unfortunately, it's really scarce. One example here of fossiliferous assemblage method. So it's based on the assemblage of fossils found in a given layer. So here, different species A, B, C, D, and E of the fossils. And we assume that all fossils found together on a sedimentary layer represent organisms that have all lived on the same time. So here, the age of these assemblages is the age of the layer containing the fossils. And briefly, lineage zone or phylozone, it's almost the same thing, but it's for one species. So strata containing clearly defined proportion of an evolutionary lineage mark above and below by some distinct and specific change in form. So here, this method defined a Middle Devonian age. So to sum up the relative dating, so we have physical methods like horizontality, superposition, cross-cutting, and conformity. We have also paleontological methods using biostratigraphy, like taxon range, fossiliferous assemblage, and lineage. But we have also a lot of methods like magnetostratigraphy, paleomagnetic dating, chemostratigraphy. And all these methods allow us to do a relative scale of geological times. So here is an example of magnetostratigraphy. So different rocks contain magnetic minerals like magnetite. Here is an example in magmatic rocks, so on lava. So during cooling of the lava, the grain of magnetite records the Earth's magnetic field. And during cooling, all these particles are orientated in the same direction, the direction of Earth's magnetic field. So it's really useful, especially in magmatic rocks, which contain a lot of magnetic minerals. Here is an example of India in the Deccan Traps, where the magmatic or the lava layer record different Earth magnetic field. So in red, you have the normal polarity of the Earth magnetic field, and in blue, it's the reverse one. So during time, we can record reverse and normal polarity of the field. And with this data, we can define a magnetosome, which are reversal and normal record of the Earth's magnetic field. And the duration of this magnetosome is a cron. Here are a lot of cron during time between the Jurassic and today. And it allows us to define different time. So to sum up, the scale of geological time try to correlate biozones, the biostratigraphy, geological stage, which use chronostratigraphy, the magnetic inversion, which use magnetostratigraphy, but also radiometric dating, which use geochronology. So all these methods define the geological scale, like here, and allow us to perform this very famous stratigraphic chronology of Earth. So to better improve the age of this layer, we use absolute method like radiometric dating. So it's comprised the classical isotopic dating like uranium lead, samarium neodym, rubidium strontium, or potassium argon, but also different methods like fission track dating, cosmogenic nuclei geochronology, dendrochronology, which use wood, etc. So first of all, radiometric dating use radioactivity. And the radioactivity was discovered by Marie and Pierre Curie at the beginning of the 20th century. And it provides an absolute age for the geological record. So this radiometric dating uses certain chemical elements which have the property to disintegrate radioactively during time. And by calculating the time that a certain amount of an element contained in a mineral or in rocks has disintegrated, we obtain the age of formation or crystallization of these minerals. So just a reminder, so the radioactivity decay use the science of the chemistry, so an atom contain a nucleus here, which contain proton and neutron, around which the electron gravitates here. The atom mass is concentrated in the nucleus here because the electrons having a negligible mass. So we use two different parameters, two different numbers. First of all, the atomic mass, which is the number of protons and the number of neutrons, and also the atomic number, which is the number of protons. So each element is defined by their atomic mass and by their atomic number. So the radioactivity decay, named also radioactivity, is the process by which an unstable atomic nucleus loses energy in terms of mass by emitting radiation such as an alpha or beta particles with a neutrino or only with a neutrino in the case of electron capture, gamma ray or electron in the case of internal conversion. And the material containing such unstable nuclei is considered radioactive. So different examples. First of all, the alpha decay, which where we have an ejection of an alpha particle, so the helium nucleus from the nucleus. So we have a loss of 4 in the atomic mass and a loss of 2 in the atomic number. For example, the samarium neodym radioactivity. The beta decay, where the nucleus loses excess energy through the ejection of either an electron or a positron. So we have a gain of 1 in the atomic number, but no change of atomic mass because the electron has a negligible mass. So for example, the rubidium strontium radioactivity. And then the electron capture, which is essentially the reverse of beta decay. So we have a loss of 1 in the atomic number here, but no change in the atomic mass. So the example is the potassium-argon radioactivity. And we have also gamma decay, where we observe any change in the atomic number or mass. But this decay is common means by which a nucleus emits energy to move from an excited state to a more stable state. So here, some examples where so the star indicates a nucleus in an excited state. So the principle of radioactivity. So the disintegration reaction can be summarized like that. So we have a parent element, for example, uranium. And this element gradually transforms into a daughter element, for example, lead. And this disintegration takes time. So after a time T1 here, the original quantity of the parent element here will be transformed into an amount R1 here of daughter element. And there will remain only a quantity P1 of the parent element, which can be expressed by the ratio R1 on P1. After a time T2, we obtain a ratio R2 on P2 greater than the previous one. So the value of the ratio R on P is thus a function of disintegration time. And the rate of this disintegration is different from one type of disintegration to another, but always the same for a given disintegration. So the big question is when the disintegration has begun. So here we have a graph. So it's the amount of parent element during time. And the disintegration reaction is not linear, but exponential. And the decay rate decreases with time, very rapid at first, and decreases more slowly after. So an important parameter is the half-life. So it is the period of time required for half of a mass of the radioactive parent element to decay away. So here is an example for uranium lead radioactivity, and the half-life is 4.5 billion years. So just to sum up, in time zero, we have 100% of the radioactive parent after 4.5 billion years, so which corresponds to the half-life of the uranium lead radioactivity. So we have just 50% of the parent element and 50% of the daughter element, so the uranium, the lead, after 9 billion years. We have 25% of uranium and 75% of lead, etc. So the parent element, named here N, decay at different rates during time. So we obtain this equation, and the solution of this equation is this equation, where N0 is the value of the parent element at time zero. The number of daughter elements, named R, produced is N0 more NT, and we obtain this equation, and the solution is this equation. And it's a very important equation because it's the starting point for geochronology. So here is some example of a really famous radioactivity, very useful in geology. First of all, potassium argon. So with a half-life of 1.25 billion years, we have also rubidium strontium, samarium neodym, uranium lead, thorium lead, lutetium hafnium, but also rhenium osmium, really useful in organic rich sediment. So we have now a lot of questions. So which dating method for what type and age of rocks? So what do you want to date? A metamorphic or a magmatic process? A sedimentary origin? The age of diagenesis? Do you want to date minerals, rocks, organic material, old or young material? So it's a lot of questions. So here are commonly used techniques. So first of all, radiocarbon dating. So by measuring the decay of carbon-14 in organic material, and we can be applied to sample younger than 60,000 years. So it's useful for very recent material. Uranium lead dating, which measures the ratio of two lead isotopes, the lead 206 and 207, to the amount of uranium in a mineral or in a rock. This method is commonly used for geological dating and is applied to samples older than 1 million years. We have also uranium-thorium dating, which is very useful to date speleothems, corals, carbonates, fossil bones, etc. And its range is from a few years to about 700,000 years. The potassium argon and argon-argon dating, which can be applied to date metamorphic but also magmatic event. And the Younger limit of the argon-argon method is a few thousand years. So different, very useful minerals. We have zircon, which is a silicate, monazite and xenotime, which are phosphate. We have also rutile, baddeleyite, but we can also date carbonates. These different minerals and rocks can be determine the age of magmatic processes, metamorphic processes, diagenesis, but also with different tools like zircon, we can obtain age and sources of sediments during time. So why zircon? Zircon is a very useful mineral. So it's a silicate containing zirconium, but also a small part of uranium. Zircon are produced in magmatic and or metamorphic process. So they grow during magmatic and metamorphic process. It's here an example. So we observe different parts in the zircon. We have oscillatory zoning. And one zircon can record different magmatic or metamorphic process. So for example, we have here a very old core and younger zonation here. So zircon are also present in sedimentary, but also like inherited minerals. It has a very high hardness between 7 and 7.5. So it's really resistant to erosion and alteration. So it's really useful to perform dating. And it incorporates uranium and thorium during crystallization. So here are two really famous examples. So it's the zircon from Jack Hills in Western Australia. And it is the oldest minerals on Earth, dated between 4 and 4.4 billion years, like here. So now, in uranium lead dating, we use two different lead to uranium radioactivity. So we have the lead 206 and lead 207, which are disintegrated to uranium 238 and 235. And we can obtain the age, the time here, so the age of different mineral containing uranium and lead. So we can obtain this really important diagram. It's the Concordia diagram, which represents the ratio on lead on uranium. And we obtain here a curve for the time. So at 4.5 billion years, we have a high amount of lead compared to the uranium here and here. And during time, the lead are disintegrated to uranium. So we have today a low amount of this ratio. So now I present you two different examples. First of all, a geochronology study on Paleo-Archean metamorphic zircon and monazite in the Pilbara Craton located in Australia. And also the implication of geochronology to determine primitive geodynamic processes on early Earth. The second example is a couple study of different geochronology study using uranium lead, rhenium osmium, but also argon on proterozoic rocks from the Congo Basin. And this method allows us to define the age of diagenesis, but also microfossils containing in this sedimentary succession, and allow us to perform an age for the diversification of early eukaryotes in Africa and more broadly on the world. So the first example is my PhD study performed in the Pilbara Craton in Australia. So it's a geochronology, a petrology, and a numerical modeling study on rocks, on Archean rocks. So this study is included in the actual debate on the origin of plate tectonic on Earth, and when and how the plate tectonic began. So first of all, after accretion of the Earth around 4.6 billion years, we have the Hadean period. During this period, we have the record of the oldest jacket zircon, around 4.4 and 4 billion years. The boundary between Hadean and Archean is the oldest evidence of rocks. And during Archean, we record a massive growth of continental crust on Earth. And then during the boundary between late Archean and Paleo-Proterozoic, we have a major change in Earth, like oxygen in atmosphere, but also the probably first evidence of plate tectonic, including subduction, with the oldest eclogite known between 1.8 and probably 2.1 billion years. So it's a really important period, this limit. And so the big question is which geodynamic process existed in the primitive Earth? Was there plate tectonic, included subduction, collision, and some formation of oceanic crust like today? But also, were they similar to present ones? And how to characterize these processes? So today, geodynamic processes included plate tectonic. It's like that. So we have the formation of oceanic crust in the spreading ridge here. And then we have the subduction processes, where the oceanic crust sink into the mantle. We have formation of metamorphic rocks here, but also formation of a lot of magma here, and also the formation of the continental crust during collision. It's just a reminder for the metamorphic subduction. So we have oceanic crust, which is cold and hydrated, and with this high density, they sink into the mantle. And the oceanic crust, composed of basalt and gabbro, are transformed during metamorphism. So basalt are transformed first of all in green schist, after in blue schist, and after in eclogite. So the subduction processes is really important to know the geodynamic processes, and also the metamorphic rocks produced during subduction is really, really important. So what about primitive Earth? So the primitive Earth present different thermal conditions with a higher mantle heat flux, but also with different lithologies, like a hot and weak crust named TTG, and a thick and dense continental flood basalt named greenstone. So here we have a world map of Archean lithology on Earth. And what is the Archean rocks? So here are two examples of really famous Archean rocks. So first of all, the greenstone, which include comatite, like here. So it's really green rocks. And also it contains metamorphic rocks, like amphibolite and different metamorphic rocks also. And we have also the TTG. So TTG is for tonalite, trondhjemite, and granodiorite. So it means just granitoid, so rocks with quartz and feldspar only. So in the primitive Earth, we have probably different processes, and subduction is proposed. So subduction, or it's also named mobile light tectonics, like here. So we have an oceanic crust sink into the mantle. But for subduction, we need plates. And we have also the subduction processes, which also named stagnant lead tectonics. So it is an intraplate process, so we don't need any plates for that. And the subduction is a convective overturn by density contrast between the greenstone layer here with a very high density. So the density is higher than the granitoid basement. And with this contrast of density, the greenstone sink into the lower crust. And in the same times, we have a hot crust. So we have partial melting in the lower crust. And then the formation of TTG dome by convection. So my main objectives to better understand the pressure, the temperature, and time signature of archaean processes on early Earth is to use different metamorphic rocks from Pilbara Craton. So the Pilbara Craton presents archaean rocks dated between 3.2 and 3.6 billion years. So we have TTG dome surrounded by greenstone belt here, and we have also evidence of metamorphic rocks. These metamorphic rocks are studied by thermobarometric investigation, so pressure and temperature determination to obtain, for example, the depth of these processes. We also perform a thermomechanical modeling to verify if these processes are viable or not for early Earth. And also, of course, geochronology study to determine the age of the metamorphisms, but also the duration of this phenomenon. So we are here in the 3.2, 3.6 billion year Western Australia. So we have ovoid dome of TTG, so the granitoid. And we have also greenstone here in green. And we focus our study here in the Warrawoona Greenstone Belt, which is a very big shear zone. So here we can see the granitoid dome and the shear zone, which contain greenstone, but also metamorphic rocks. So the dome are polyphased. So different granitoid bodies are inside, dated between 3.5 and 3.3 billion years. And in the greenstone belt here, we have rocks dated between 3.5 and 3.3 million years. And we know that the end of deposit are at 3.15 million years. So we also sample metamorphic rocks, both outside in the shear zone here, but also in an enclave trapped inside the granitic dome. So we have here the metamorphic rocks from the dome, and here some example in the shear zone. So first of all, it's just two pictures of the field trip. So here in the shear zone, we observed very strong deformation. So first of all, the enclave here put an interesting problem. So why are metamorphic rocks inside the dome? So how old is this enclave? It is a witness of an older crust. And are there detrital or metamorphic zircon inside? So these rocks are a typical metasedimentary rock. So it's a metamorphic rocks with a sedimentary origin. And it contains typical minerals such garnet, muscovite, biotite, sillimanite, and quartz. And the composition of these rocks are felsic, which means rich in silicate, aluminium, and iron. So it's a typical from sedimentary rocks. Secondly, we perform pressure and temperature investigation. So it's modeling, and we can obtain for our minerals and for a type of composition the pressure and the temperature. So we obtain here for this rock a relative high temperature around 700 degrees and a mid pressure around 7 kilobar. So we are in the amphibolite to granulite fascias. It just means high temperature and mid pressure. And then we perform also a geochronology study on zircon here, and we obtain an age at 12 million years. And we know that this age is a metamorphic age because inside the zircon we have inclusion of metamorphic minerals. So we know that this age is metamorphic. And we also perform oxygen isotope study on this enclave, and we obtain a very high delta O18, so it just means that we have supracrustal or sedimentary rocks, but no magmatic origin. So we have a sedimentary origin for these rocks. So to sum up, we have a felsic composition, so a sedimentary rocks or metasedimentary rocks. The metamorphisms is high temperature and mid pressure. We have metamorphic zircon and we have a metasedimentary origin. So this enclave suggests a burial until the granulitic condition, so high temperature and mid pressure. So it corresponds to the lower crust, and then exhumation doing a unique cycle of subduction and exhumation in dome by convection. So we have a very fast crustal loop doing this age, so this metamorphic age between at 12 million years, and the end of the deposit in the shear zone at 15 million years. So subduction is a very fast process. We have also sample come from the rim of the dome in the shear zone. So it's also a metasedimentary rocks with garnet, muscovite, staurolite, and andalusite, which just mean low pressure, low temperature, so around 550 degrees, but higher pressure around 11 kilobar. We also perform dating, but here it's on monazite trap in a very big garnet, and the age obtained is 345 million years. And we know that this age is also metamorphic age. So to sum up, here are the pressure and temperature recorded by all the samples. And we observe a maximum of pressure around 12 kilobar. We observed also a large temperature range between 500 until 760. But also a progressive temperature increase between rims in the shear zone and to the core. So we have two metamorphic geological events, and we have a very well-constrained geology of this Archean craton. We know the lithologies, we know the stratigraphy, the age, the density, the metamorphism, the PT condition. So to better understand dome formation, time, pressure and temperature condition, burial and exhumation during this subduction processes, and also to compare this pressure, temperature, time evolution model to our metamorphic rocks, we perform a thermomechanical modeling using the software Ellipsis. So it's a 2D thermomechanical modeling using particle in cell method. And here is the model for the subduction. So we have a layer of greenstone with 15 kilometers and with a higher density than their granitoid basement. And we can record different parameters during time with this colored particle, like viscosity, pressure, temperature, and time. And is the result. So here on the left is the subduction process. So we have here in blue and green the greenstone layer, and here in yellow and red the protocrust basement, so the granitoid basement. Color just indicates the viscosity and change of temperature. And on the right part is the thermal, is the corresponding thermal history during time. So we observe a long period of incubation around 140 million years, so it's very long. But after, we observe a very rapid subduction in a few million years, so maybe 5 million years, and or where the greenstone layer are sink into the lower crust. We observe also partial melting here in red, and the formation of TTG dome by convection. And then we observe a long period of thermal relaxation around 25 million years. So here are some colored particles which record pressure, temperature, and time. And these particles are initially located in the greenstone layer. And first of all, we observe an increase of pressure corresponding to the sinking into the lower crust condition. And then an increase of temperature corresponding to the partial melting in the lower crust. Then a decrease of pressure corresponding to the exhumation inside dome, here and here. But the temperature are constant. And so burial and exhumation are very, very fast in less than 10 million years. And after, we observe the thermal relaxation with a decrease of temperature. So now we can compare the pressure, temperature, time obtained with our metamorphic study with these models. So we have here the thermobarometric investigation, and in the second plan, the thermomechanical modeling. And it's really, really consistent. So to sum up this study, we have a very typical TTG dome and a greenstone basin. So we have a typical structure of TTG and greenstone greenstone belts. We use petrology on metamorphic rocks to determine pressure and temperature, but also a geochronology study to determine the age of metamorphic rocks. And we obtain two different metamorphic history. So we have a polymetamorphic history in this part of Australia. We have also thermomechanical modeling on the subduction processes. And our result obtained by metamorphic study and geochronology study are really compatible with this model. So we propose a simple model of polysubduction for this area. So now the second example. So we use here different dating method to define age of a sedimentary succession located in Central Africa in Democratic Republic of the Congo. So we are in the Congo Craton here, and especially in the Kasai block part here. So this sedimentary succession named the Mbujimai supergroup is located between Archean to Paleoproterozoic Kasai block, so the Congo Craton. And we have also Mesoproterozoic Kibarian belt on the eastern part. So we have here a sedimentary succession dated in the boundary between Meso and Neoproterozoic time. So we have different parts in this supergroup, a lower part here, the B1 group, and a lower part, the B2 group. This supergroup unconformably on the old 2.6, 2.8 billion years Congo Craton here. We have different age performed in this sedimentary succession. We have an irritated age obtained on zircon here. We have also very old dating obtained in the 30s by lead-lead method. And we have also here age obtained on lava topping the supergroup with the potassium-argon method obtained in the 50s. So the goal of this study is to date precisely the diagenesis, so the deposit of sedimentary rocks, because it contains a large diversity of well-preserved acritarchs. So acritarchs is organic whale microfossils, evidencing the diversification of complex life, so the early eukaryote for the first time in Africa and more broadly in the world. So this sedimentary succession contains 11 species of unambiguous eukaryotes. So the fossiliferous assemblages and the biostratigraphy study reveal an age at the boundary of meso and neoproterozoic. So here to here. So for this, I study different samples from different drill cores performed in the 50s by the Royal Museum of Central Africa located in Belgium. And we obtain different cores. First of all, the lower parts, which are principally or mainly siliciclastic rocks, like in the Kafuku drill core, but also in the Lubi drill core. And then the upper part here in blue is mainly composed of carbonated sequences with a very thin layer of organic rich shale, like here. So we have here carbonate and organic rich shale, which contain microfossils. And lava topping the supergroup here. And this lava are previously dated around 950 million years. So now I have different examples of the geochronology study. So we obtain different ages. First of all, on samarium neodym on lava, so it's a wool rock dating. So we obtain this age. And then we perform uranium lead on titanite. So titanites are minerals like zircon, for example. And we obtain this age, correspond to this diagram. And we have also performed argon-argon on feldspath, and we obtain this age. So do you have an idea on what or which age is good or not? No? This one is good or not? Strange, no? No. Yeah, because the error is really too high. Why? Because samarium neodym dating use neodym and samarium neodym ratio obtained on salt minerals. And in this case, it happens, the individual data are really good with small error, but the time right here is not enough defined because we don't have enough radiogenic isotope of samarium. So it's happened. It's alive. Then we have uranium lead on titanite. So this age is good or not? Much better, yeah. But we know with biostratigraphy that this supergroup is dated in the meso-neoproterozoic boundary. Too high. Do you have an explanation? It's a good data, but you need to interpret them.
It may depend on the quantity of uranium you have in the lab.
Yeah, sure.
If you have more uranium in the space, the
yeah, but why?
It was not closed system.
No. It's an inherited age. It corresponds to the Archean Craton. Okay, so it's a good age, but it's just inherited minerals trapped in the sedimentary sequence. Okay. And then this one, good or not? So, yes. So it's obtained on the lava topping the supergroup. So meso-neoproterozoic boundary, it's perfect. Then dating obtained on shale. So the rhenium osmium dating obtained in Kanchi drill core, so it's the top of the supergroup. And here in Kafuku, it's the lower part. So good or not? The first one? Not really. The same problem. The error is very, very too high because not enough radiogenic is the isotope here. It happens. And the second one? Not bad, yes. It's good. And the last example is obtained on sandstone and siltstone in the lower part in two different drill cores. So we obtain this age, so between 1 and 2.8 billion years. So it's obtained on xenotime and monazite, which are phosphates, and also in zircon. So good or not? And why? Yes, it's good because we have inherited age record, for example, in the core of zircon, and we have around 1 billion years the diagenetic age. Okay? So geochronology is a powerful tool, but we need to interpret this data. So now the explanation. So first of all, I focus my study on the B1 group, which contains siliciclastic rocks. And for that, my research strategy is to use zircon, xenotime, and monazite with two different methods. First of all, laser ablation ICP-MS, so it's a mass spectrometer. This method is really good because it provides very low error on age. But unfortunately, the spot of this data is very big, around 10 to 20 micrometer. So sometimes we date a mix between inherited and on another age. So it's a good method, but we need to compare with this second method. So this one uses isotopic dating, but here it's chemical dating. So you just measure uranium, lead, and thorium in monazite or xenotime. So it's electron microprobe. And this method provides very low resolution spot of analysis, around 1 micrometer. So it's really good. We can also perform age dating or age map. So here we have a monazite with different zoning, and we observe an inherited core and very thin rim with a different age. So it's really, really powerful. But this method provides a very high error. So it's really important to use both of these methods together. So here are the first result of chemical dating with electron microprobe on monazite and xenotime with a monazite inclusion here. And we have different ages obtained on the monazite inclusion on the xenotime. And here we observe an external zoning with the different ages here. And it corresponds to the diagenetic rims around 1040 and 1050. So just for a comparison, here is a spot of laser ablation, and here the spot of electron microprobe. And the error is low here, and the error is very big here. Here are some age mapping in two different monazite, and we observe zoning with an internal core which is inherited, but also very thin rims here. So we have thorium lead and uranium lead and uranium map, and we can obtain with this concentration the age of these minerals, especially in the external rim. So it corresponds to the blue spot, and we obtain age around 1055 million years, corresponding to the diagenetic age. We also perform laser ablation isotopic dating on xenotime, monazite, and zircon, and we obtain this very large range of age between 2.8 and 1 billion years. We have diagenetic xenotime here, is here, yep, corresponding to the diagenetic age. And we have also inherited age recorded by zircon, xenotime, and monazite between 1 and 2.8 billion years. So now, with this dating, we can reconstruct the sediment origin during time. So we are here in the Lubi and Kafuku drill core. So it's the Mbujimai supergroup. Here are the Congo Kasai Craton, the Mesoproterozoic Kibaria belt, and different cratons locating on the eastern part. Here is are the edge in purple in Kafuku drill core and in green in the Lubi drill core. And we record a lot of peak age, like here, corresponding to the age of Archean Craton. And then here, corresponding to the metasedimentary complex trap in the Congo Craton. Then here, a peak corresponding to the Paleoproterozoic belt locating in the eastern part of the Mbujimai supergroup. Then another orogenic belt here in the Kibaha. And then a very small peak around 1 billion years corresponding to the diagenesis of the Mbujimai supergroup. So the sediment origin can be also recorded in different locations in the basin. So we have a very big basin, and the sediment origin are different in Lubi and Kafuku drill core. We have, for example, here a big peak, but not here. And in Kafuku, we have a big peak here, but not here. Okay, so it's really useful to determine the sediment origin. And we can also reconstruct sediment origin during time. So here is the drill core of Lubi, here the Kafuku drill core. And during time, it changes. Okay? So for example, here the peak is low, but here is really high in the same drill core. Okay? So now we focus our study on the B2 group containing carbonate and shale, and also on lava. So for the lava, we perform argon-argon dating, and for the shale, which are rich in organic matter, we use rhenium-osmium dating on organic matter. So here are some pictures of the lava. So it's a basaltic lava. And here are some results on potassic feldspar on the lava. So this dating allows us to define the end of the diagenesis around 1,000 million years. And then different shales. So you know this graph here in the Kafuku drill core and here in the upper part in the Kanchi drill core. Here we have a good dating with the end of the diagenesis around 1040. And here some problem. So just as a conclusion for this part, we have diagenesis of B2 group between 1030 and 1000 recorded in the lava. For the B1 group, here we have diagenesis between 1030, 1040, and 1065. And this dating allows us to perform sedimentary sources during time. So we have an Archean to Proterozoic origin with multiple provenances from Congo Craton and from the network of belts on the south and eastern part of the supergroup. So it means we have the presence of natural barriers between the continent and the sedimentary basin, which block temporarily the supply of sediment during time. We have diagenesis, so between here 1065 and 1000, and it is confirmed by biostratigraphy study. And we constrain on the timing of yearly eukaryotes diversification and contributing to a better understanding of early biosphere evolution with dating. So as a conclusion of this talk, geochronology is a powerful tool, but it's just a tool, okay? We can determine different processes like geodynamic, metamorphism, magmatic event, but also we can obtain age on diagenesis and also age of fossil and microfossils. But it's just a tool. It provides an age which must be interpreted. And we absolutely need to combine geochronology with another approaches like field geology, petrology, modeling, stratigraphy, biostratigraphy, etc. Yes, and that's it.